So I'm going to tell you a bit about what happened in 2021. As I said, it was a challenging year. And in terms of the work that we undertook in Calgary Arts Development, kind of since 2020, when all of this all happened, we asked ourselves, what is this moment asking of us? And how might we use the resources and the gifts that we have to bring to serve artists and organizations and those in the arts ecosystem in a good way? So in 2021, we invested $11.6 million through over 500 grants that resulted in almost 22,000 arts activities online, in real life, and everything in between, with a total participation number of 4 million people. That is an extraordinary thing when you think about what 2021 was, as we kind of sat, are we in it, are we not in it, those kinds of things. And so the return that all of you made on the investment that we make on behalf of the citizens of Calgary included economic and social benefits to Calgary. So thank you for that. Programs that we were able to support and the individuals that we were able to support were not only a result of the funds that we received from the City of Calgary, but also a significant investment that was leveraged via the Calgary Arts Foundation, which is a partner, colleague, a co-conspirator in supporting the vibrancy and the vitality of the arts ecosystem in Calgary. And I know that we have Board Chair Dean Proden and Board Member Teresa Wupa, and I think maybe Karen Prentice might be here, and Bev Foy might be here. Bev Foy is here because I saw her before. So I wanted to particularly thank the Calgary Arts Foundation. This was an idea that was brewing for a number of years, and then we sort of said, okay, we're all going to get up and get going in 2020. And there you go. It was 2020. And what this group of individuals did to raise $400,000 like that in support of individual artists who were struggling from the results of the pandemic, being in the pandemic, was an extraordinary thing. And here we are in 2022. And they not only raised $400,000 once, they did it again in 2021 and are well on their way to doing it again in 2022. So that's $1 million that will be invested in the sector that might not otherwise have been invested into artists in particular. So my sincere thanks and appreciation to all of you for that. For contributing and giving that gift in such a good way of your time. On these next slides, you can see the list of programs, our largest being the operating grant program, and then others going to the project grants for organizations, for individual artists, and grants with specific focus, like our Original People's Investment Program, focusing on First Nations, Métis, and Inuit artists. Our programs also included promoting cultural activation and tourism, like through the Cultural Activation Fund, and also grants supporting art for social change, like our Changemaker grants. We are very careful, because the more programs you have, the more challenging it can become to administer. And that being said, we also have a design principle that we live by, which is called one size fits one. So when we think about the grant investments that we make, it isn't about just throwing it all into one big pot and then kind of seeing where it goes from there. The community investment team led by Melissa Tuplin is very, very thoughtful about how we might make those grants in a way that leads to the most meaning and impact. So back to meaning again. And so we walk that fine line of not too many programs, but also not too few. And as our resources have grown, our budgets have grown, the opportunity to create these programs has been extraordinary. And I would particularly point out the Original People's Investment Program. That program was centered and created by Indigenous artists. And it is an exemplar program in the country. Sable, our Director of Reconciliation and Engagement, gets phone calls and emails from all over the place asking how we did that. And so I'm really proud of that program and very grateful to Sable and the team for leading us on that journey. 2020, Calgary Arts Development undertook a survey of arts professionals to better understand their status in Calgary. And the results, which we shared in 2021, painted a pretty bleak picture of how COVID affected individual artists and arts workers. As I said, the arts have been one of the hardest hit industries, and it will likely be the last to recover. And, you know, I know I'm saying stuff to people who already know this because you're living it. But I wanted to share with you what I shared with City Council so that you knew what I shared and said to them. The pandemic impacted artists' ability to earn a living, to create art, to present their creations, and has had a negative effect on the perceptions of Calgary. The findings from the report: individual artists were very hard hit. Over 70% reported that their ability to generate self-employment income was reduced. 57% earned an income under $35,000 per year, much lower than the Calgary average of $60,000 per year. And 24% of those who responded anticipated leaving Calgary within the next 2 years. So in that context of how people were feeling in 2020, we discovered that the arts contribute, and did contribute in this time, to a more vibrant downtown, enlivening neighborhoods in every ward of the city. And in a package that we sent over to council several weeks ahead of the meeting, we included a ward report that showed for every organization that we invested in, if they presented, exhibited, created, where in the wards they did that, to show that the investments we make aren't just in the downtown, but they permeate throughout the city, through all 14 wards, which is something that I think surprises them. There's this perception that it's only wards 7, 8, and 9. And to be fair, a lot happens, 50% in those wards. The other 50%, however, is taking place throughout the rest of the city. And so artists live everywhere. They undertake their practice and work everywhere in the city, and we wanted to make that clear. The other thing I think worth noting, and I'm sure many of you have heard of this, the Economist Intelligence Unit, the magazine The Economist, rated Calgary as the third most livable city in the world, just like a couple of weeks ago. And so that's a bunch of big heads somewhere in the UK who have all these rankings and do all this stuff, and we jumped from 14th in 2021 to third, and we're the highest ranked city. Canadian city, so ahead of Toronto and Vancouver. And one of the things that really tipped us and moved us up the ranks was one of the categories is called culture and environment. And we went from being ranked in the 80 percentile to the 90 percentile. So you make a difference to making a more livable city for Calgary. From an economic impact perspective, arts provide jobs, they generate revenue as part of the creative economy, which coming out of the pandemic continues to be one of the fastest growing economic bands, if you will, in the world. So that creative spirit continued. People kept, you know, even though the pandemic hampered our your ability to create, to share, didn't stop it. And so that creative economy continues to grow in a significant way. In 2021, 7,938 artists were hired, and the total number of full-time equivalent arts workers was 689. Still lower than what it was in 2019, but certainly significantly more than what it was in 2020. So that ability to try and recover and get back to hiring, creating, presenting, sharing work, really came up. Arts organizations that we invested in had an accumulated revenue of $121 million and a direct total economic output of $119 million. And that's compared to $132 million and $131 million respectively in 2019. So again, you know, although we saw healthier balance sheets, you know, mostly because of things like the wage subsidies and the rent subsidies and all those kinds of things in queues. It's not like y'all hoarded the money. You spent it. And so we saw healthier balance sheets, but we also saw that organizations tried very hard to get back up, get going for the benefit of the community again. In terms of young people, the total number of arts experiences produced by grantees was almost 22,000, as I said, with just under 5,000 being specifically for youth, with youth attendance and participation of 195,000, give or take. That is a number we need to work on. That is quite a bit lower than what it was in 2019, which was 9,000 events and about 347,000 participation. And I don't think there's anybody in this room who wouldn't be able to provide a long case for why exposing and introducing and including young people in arts experiences is so important. So that is definitely an area that as we, and it was going down anyway in 2019, we were just coming up and we thought we were turning the corner, but now it's gone way down. And so that's something that we're definitely in conversation and engagement and consultation with in community in that regard. In terms of our equity and inclusion, artists tell our story. You shape the identity of our city. And yesterday, Mayor Gondek, when she started us off, she said that. And she's been traveling. She'd just come back from Toronto, where the Connections Conference happens, which is this giant IT conference. And she shared with them that Calgary's ranking as the third most livable city and our economy coming back and all of those kinds of things are shared through the stories that artists tell about us. She knows you are our storytellers, you are our meaning makers, you are our sense makers, and is really doing a great job of crediting that in our community right now. In 2021, there were more than 4,000 activities that specifically engaged racialized communities, and that was compared to 4,700 in 2019. Just under 2,000 people were engaged with disabilities, compared to 486 in 2019. 1,700 activities engaging Indigenous communities, relative to 1,256 in 2019. And among the two SLGBTQIA plus communities, 611 compared to 555. So again, we see more organizations, more in the community. We're becoming more familiar and building good relations with organizations and groups from these communities. And so we're seeing that lift, and I think that's a wonderful thing. Last March, Calgary Arts Development was selected as the future provider of the public art program. And I know our director of public art, Brandy DeRouge, and members of her team are here, so I encourage you to meet them later on. And 2021, we completed the first in a three-year transition from the city to Calgary Arts Development. And it's just been a ride. I would tell you I should have asked ahead of time what your favorite treats and your favorite gifts and stuff were, because my public art team really needs it a lot. They are taking on just a huge undertaking. It's extraordinary, and I'm thrilled that Calgary Arts Development can be a part of the story of public art in this time, because we have a pretty extraordinary story and a collection that is outstanding. There are over 200 pieces in the public realm. The permanent collection of the City of Calgary is over 2,000 pieces, which makes it one of the largest public collections in North America. And that includes like provincial, municipal, all that kind of stuff. So it's really quite extraordinary. And the story of public art has been around, again, since time immemorial. You saw that sun wheel at Nose Hill Park in the video. There have been those places where people could connect and gather through beauty and visual symbols. In addition, in 2021, just starting up, Kate ran two small programs in the public art team. The community-run public art microgrant program invested $100,000 in 11 projects, and the artist-initiated public art microgrant program invested $144,000 in four projects. So the great thing about public art is sometimes it is initiated by community, and sometimes it's initiated by artists. And so there's a really great kind of discourse that I think is encouraged and takes place within that realm. Our commitment to equity is now posted, and it has been a journey. You can ask anybody on the team about that. It's taken us a really long time. We were very, very thoughtful and very careful about how we crafted that commitment, how we talked with others and our own communities about it, and wanted to ensure that we were presenting it in a thoughtful and good way. And so it just went live on our site, and our commitment to equity, diversity, inclusion, and accessibility continues to deepen. We learn more and more every day, and I hope, I feel like we continue farther along our path in our reconciliation journey. Our staff members continue to sit on a variety of committees, including the Calgary Local Immigrant Partnership, the Anti-Racism Funders Table, which includes individuals from the City of Calgary, Calgary Foundation, Government of Alberta, United Way, Canadian Heritage, and the Canadian Race Relations Foundation. We have the great privilege of working with a group of IBPOC individuals, the Community Working Group, who are practicing artists and arts workers involved in social justice, change making, or equity organizing in community. In 2021, they helped us improve our hiring process. They helped us develop our commitment to equity statement and investigated methods of conflict resolution. It's one way that we hope we are developing embedded community engagement and working towards new levels of shared leadership. The cultural instigators are citizen artists who work in community to make things better for and with artists through an anti-racism lens. This button about bringing power to truth is them. And it's just such a privilege and an honor to be associated with the cultural instigators and to support them, but not lead them in any way. Through their major project, Bringing Power to Truth, they are investigating what does an anti-racist, Mohinsist Calgary look like, led by a group of artists. And the findings are incredible. Our most recent webisode, all these language things, of Living a Creative Life actually features the grappling that took place a few weeks ago. I encourage you to have a look at it. It's really wonderful and inspiring. And we believe in the power of arts to contribute to social change. The Artists as Changemaker program is a partnership between Calgary Arts Development and the Trico Changemaker Studio at Mount Royal University. And it investigates the ways artists use their skills to tackle complex problems like racism, ageism, and domestic violence. Our partnership with the Changemaker Studio also includes developing a stronger network for those practicing community-based art and art for social change in Calgary. Now, like our partnership with the Trico Changemaker Studio, partnerships are super important to us. By supporting initiatives like Rise Up YYC and Chinook Blast, we are creating, I hope, more opportunities for the arts ecosystem in partnership with other city builders like Tourism Calgary, Calgary Economic Development, the Calgary Hotel Association. This is about creating events and experiences for Calgarians that range from small pop-up performances in parks throughout Calgary to large-scale spectacle events like Chinook Blast events that drew thousands of people downtown this past year, 2022. So it's not really 21, but you know, they had 300,000 people in 2021. We had 450,000 people in 2022. And in particular, and Teresa, I know you'll like to hear this, we had a night market inside the City Hall atrium as one of the Chinook Blast events. 15,000 Calgarians went through the atrium after hours when usually City Hall people will tell you, you're not supposed to be in there, it's not for you, it's not a public space, go away. And thanks to the wonderful team who put the night market together, the space became theirs. And it was really extraordinary, and we're hoping it is one of many, many more events like that to take place inside the atrium. I hope that Calgary Arts Development are good collaborators. We certainly, as I said, believe in the power of partnerships. And one thing in particular is the Civic Partners is a group of organizations that run the gamut. There's no real kind of reason or thing that makes them all the same that would make them part of this group beyond the city says we're all Civic Partners. So it includes everything from us to ECDEV, to tourism, to the library, to the Aerospace Museum, to the zoo, to Heritage Park, to some rec centers, but not all the rec centers, to the Parks Foundation. It's like a real diverse array. That being said, the investments that the city makes in those civic partners is less than 3% of the total city budget altogether. And that less than 3% that goes to those civic partners supports the work of these 21 civic partners, where if you were to add up the number of times that we connect with Calgarians, and by we, I mean all of you with whom we are in relationship with, your audiences, your donors, your volunteers, your stakeholders, it numbers in the hundreds of thousands. Well, actually it would be millions. Well, hundreds of thousands would be per week contacts that those civic partners make with Calgarians. And, you know, it's an extraordinary investment. There are not very many municipalities in the country who have a similar kind of structure or framework to invest in civic partners. It's just one of the best investments the city could ever make. And it's a good thing, members of the City Council watch this, I'm saying it to you again, that it is a great investment and it's only 3% and it really should be more. Going to the future, it takes time for us to prototype, for us to try, for us to discover it fails and then try a different way. And, you know, I used the example of the flood in 2013. Even in 2022, we are still undertaking flood mitigation, flood activities, things to do to avoid a future 100-year flood ramification again. So if we're doing that as a result of the flood, think about what the impact of the pandemic was on all of us. So it has to take some period of time. And so that's how we think about those three R's and then the resiliency piece to come later. So that then leads us to 2023 to 26. In the 4-year, so we run on a 4-year budget cycle with City Council, and we make a 4-year budget case to them, and 23 to 26 will be at the budget debates in the late fall, early winter, November, to present our budget and make our case over the fall. These are the 4 strategic priorities currently. They're in draft. The language may change a bit. There are a number of things that we've taken into consideration. We have a working committee of the board that includes the senior staff, board members, and non-board members, community members, to assist us in this, and also taking into account the strategic priorities of City Council that were published back in March. So, we wanted to give you a bit of a preview. You'll hear us talk more about that in the rest of 2022 and beyond. And really, a lot of this has been influenced by what all of you have shared with us over what you've experienced in the last 4 years, and particularly this last 2.5.
2021, like, I'm sure all of us have had this time to reflect and think deeply about the pandemic and all the things that have happened to all of us and all the things that we miss and the loss of all kinds of things and the degree of change and uncertainty. And, you know, I said it in the beginning parts of the video earlier. The other thing that it really brought to me was just a great deal of gratitude and appreciation for where I live in this place and time, as challenging as it is. Boy, oh boy, It's not as challenging or as hard in many, many other places that are very close, near to us, and are farther away. And so in thinking about that gratitude, I wanted to just acknowledge, of course, all of you in the sector, your resiliency, your ability to survive this, and continue to create and generate and use your creative spirit and the gifts that that creativity brings to our community is a truly extraordinary thing. And to get to be in the role that I'm in here at Calgary Arts Development is just incredible, and I'm so thankful to all of you. I also wanted to just acknowledge our staff team. You know, while we were in a time where most organizations involved in the arts ecosystem were losing staff, we actually were gaining staff. With the addition of the public art program and those extraordinary resources, we went from 15 people in September of 2021 to 27, 28 people today. And it has just been, and every single one of them, true creatives and artists in their own right, but so committed to our community, so, I don't have this right, like just, you know, it's that kind of colloquial, they get her done. They saw what needed to be done, and they got it done. And it was just extraordinary. And sometimes that kind of a cost to them, whether it was mentally, spiritually, tired, all those things. And so I just am so grateful to all of you. And for those of you who are new to our team at Calgary Arts Development, welcome to this ride. If we didn't tell you before, strap in. But I can assure you that when you get surrounded by people like this every day, and you see the work that is created by people like those two over there and the people that we'll hear from very, very shortly, that is the reward. That is the return that we get to see firsthand on the ground. And it is a special, special gift. Not everybody gets that. And so I say this to you in front of this community and online and all kinds of other things, that is a gift. And you should treasure that as a staff member of Calgary Arts Development. Not everybody gets to really experience the breadth and the depth and the diversity of our arts and creative communities, and you do every day. That is the return that you get from this community and from working in this job or whatever job you have here at CADA. So on behalf of all of us at CADA, I again thank all of you for that. And our full accountability report, oh, I guess I should have said this sooner because it doesn't really relate to a big to the finish. Artsaction.ca is our full report, so all of those stats that you saw in the presentation are there in their glory, and you can download a PDF and do all those kinds of things if you care to. And November 4th, put this date in your calendar. The Mayor's Lunch for Arts Champions has been reimagined to an evening event. It is now called the Celebration for the Arts, hosted by Mayor Gondek. It will take place, as I said, on November 4th at the Jack Sayer Concert Hall. We hope to see you all there. The Mayor's office is super thrilled, super excited about this new direction, and we're looking forward to being part of that ride and having all of you come with us. I think that's it. This part, me. Thank you all very much for that.